Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. One thing I love about BYU, they always clap no matter what. So that's one thing I recall from my days back in, you know, when Parley P. Barrett was the president. But so with that, we're going to have some fun today. We're going to talk about some things to give you somewhat of an idea. I have the opportunity throughout my career to do a whole bunch of different things. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about the intangible side of businesses and being builders. And I'm going to refer, rather using that the E word, I'm going to call builders, because I think that's really the most important thing is, if hopefully you take out of this, that there's all kinds of different builders and people have opportunities to be able to build things throughout their experiences. So we're going to talk a little bit about brand. And before I do that, I just try to get a little idea what the audience is. How many males do we, I'm just kidding. But so how many people out of the accounting program? Any bean counters? Okay. All right. There's a few that remembered. Secondly, how about in the finance program? All right. Entrepreneur program? Ballard Center? Janitorial services? Okay. All right. Well, very good. So my intent today is really kind of drill down and give you some personal experiences and talk about that relationship between the idea concept and moving it into things being a reality. And one of the things that obviously everything originates, and if you think about my experiences, kind of I'm going to talk about brand DNA, but everything really originates with people. So the Neff story really began way back with a couple of products. And so it originated with myself and my sons. And this is why my oldest son, who's the face of the brand, obviously I wouldn't be the face of the brand. They told me that early on. And so I was the guy behind the curtain, you know, pulling the little levers, kind of the back office guy, provided the funding and the opportunities and so forth. So it really originated with that idea and that concept. And then we moved into, it really then kind of evolves around product. And so that's kind of that second factor. And then it moves into, once you kind of get those things matched up, and then you moves from the people method to the product, and then on the process, and then ultimately runs through all those different kind of mechanisms. So that DNA, I grew up in a little town called Nampa, Idaho, and hold your applause. But I grew up as a skier. And I was actually a downhill racer because I was stupid and could go straight and couldn't turn very well. And so when I was 16 and 17, there was a couple things I wanted to do. Back then, I was a racer in warm-ups, like in basketball. Those, when you were getting ready to do a downhill course, you'd sit in a warm hut, and you'd have these warm-ups on, and you'd zip them off just like basketball. And that's where that concept of warm-ups came. And so you'd have, back in that day, you'd have little skinny little clothes on so that you wouldn't have any interruption from the aerodynamics. And so we came up with this idea to do Levi's. Take 501 Levi's, put a zipper down them. And that was kind of that first thing that I did when I was about 16. We moved on when I was, back in the day, everything was as head skis. I'm sure those of you ski, anybody? So head skis was, in my day and age, the brand. And so when I was 17, me and another friend, we came up with the concept of water skiing and going through that water skiing. And everything then would wood ski. So we developed a composite water ski. I sent that off to the president of Head, and I got a little letter back, and it said, thank you for your idea, but we're not moving down that road. 18 months later, Head made the first fiberglass water ski. So I learned a lot of things from that. And then I went through a process of putting some software programs together. I'm a lawyer by training and a tax lawyer, and so we did some things. We developed some credit incentive programs. We sold a CCH. So a bunch of different things I've done, and we've got some other releases. One plug, if you'll look at an app we just released, it's called Tumbleweed. Download that app and share it with your friends. And so we've done a lot of different things through those experiences. My background, though, professionally, my first job out of law school, I was tax counsel for Texaco. And I was given the liaison job of being the merger between Getty and Texaco, and I was a tax liaison. And so through that experience, I kind of developed some relationships and went into PricewaterhouseCoopers, and there had an opportunity to run a whole bunch of different practices. But by my nature, I took an $800,000 practice that we had in Southern California, and about 10 years later, we were about $48 million. I was in charge of the national practice and went to about $850 million. So through all those experiences, that DNA and those things I wanted to accomplish and so forth, is you kind of have that trending and of looking at opportunities. And then PwC, I was involved in doing products, building, taking consulting products, packaging them, taking them to market, and actually employed the first professional business development salespeople inside of PricewaterhouseCoopers. And the reason I say that, not to let you know and think I'm a great guy, which I am, but I sound like Donald Trump. But through those experiences, it's kind of always there, right? It's kind of always in your nature of you want to do something a little more. And I was really never content of having kind of doing that one thing, of just doing that one job. I like to tinker, and I like to kind of look at things creatively and look to build things. So my oldest son, Sean, came back from his mission from Argentina, and we set about to do a little clothing company. So we did a little bit of clothing company and ran through that. And my other son, Chip, who is both of them graduated from BYU, and then with my wife, who was the treasurer, we started up this little thing called Neff, and it was meant to be a hobby. And I think that was the fun thing. So it was meant to be able to just to do some fun things together because of all those experiences that I had as a kid growing up in Idaho. I tried to get traction with my father. And in that day and age, my father just kind of looked at me and said, go pick potatoes. And so really never kind of got that. So I waited for that opportunity because I wanted to do something with my children that would be fun and that would be significant. So the key point of that is that it's kind of about doing a family thing. And we've tried to keep the Neff business family friendly. So started in California in 2002, started in my garage. And so our first thing I still have today, we sold 38 items our first time around. Our first store kind of came up there. My son then came up to school. And I don't know how many of you guys, you know kind of that experience, but we went through this and we thought, and naturally we started getting some screen prints, went through a trademarking process. And the first thing, the reason we ended up with Neff, we came up with Nalu. So I'm doing all these trademark searches and so forth. We're looking for a name. We can't find a name, right? And so, you know, I started going, oh gosh. So about 20 different things. And if you ever, anybody been on tests, you know, you can go through, you can search all these different names for trademarks. And really couldn't find anything. And just about them, Bob Hurley, everybody's heard of Hurley, who worked at Quicksilver, he put his last name on a product and it's called Hurley. And we said, oh, well, let's do Neff. And so we got through that. It was an easy one. We ran through that. And so what we did initially is we looked at it and we started making some t-shirts. They were printed up here on State Street. We had about 50 t-shirts. And so Sean went around and so forth and started pitching some things. Sean, growing up in Southern California, we're a surfing family, snowboarding, did a little bit of skateboarding. My other two sons came here on scholarships to play volleyball, so they were involved in sand volleyball. So kind of that action sports kind of thing, extremely involved in. And so as going through this process, we're talking to all these different writers, and so these are all the snowboarders and so forth. And I looked at their contracts, being a lawyer, right? And there was all these conflicts. We say, hey, can you wear this t-shirt? And he goes, oh, wow, sorry, man. We can't really do that because I got a contract with DC or with Quicksilver or with Hurley or whoever it may be, and or Burton. I really can't do that. So I'm going through the contract. And back in that day, you know, kind of your head was an afterthought. And he says, well, there's nothing in there that precludes you from wearing a beanie. So we went out, got some little white headbands, Scripto, my son Sean wrote Neff on the front of it, went through that process, and so that's why he ended up being a headwear. Kind of driven by the preclusion of what's the opportunity? What's the opportunity to play? Our opportunity to play was in the headwear. And so that's where we went. We first made knit beanies. We had folks over in Shanghai making 300 beanie, hand knit beanies a day, and we went into the exotic wools and so forth, and eventually kind of evolved out where we ended up. The first time that we really became significant is at the X Games that were in Park City. two of the individuals that podiumed had little Neff beanies on, with a great big Neff, was on national television. And right there at that point in time, we said, wow, this could maybe be a real thing. And so that's where we evolved. And the one thing we've always looked at, we look to be kind of unique and wink. And we'll talk a little bit about that from a product perspective, from a market perspective, of really kind of releasing those points. Today, we started in a little garage, and we thought it'd be a little kind of a happy, fun thing. Turned out we're in over 6,500 locations in 51 countries in the United States. We'll do over $100 million in revenue, so at retail. So it's turned into something kind of fun. And it pays the bills, and you know, a Lamborghini's not bad. But so what we wanted to be was, we wanted to be an accessories brand. We didn't want to be a clothing brand. Clothing brand is a really a difficult business. As a matter of fact, a couple of years ago, Fortune 500 came out and they had an article, and that article said, and they looked at comparing starting a clothing brand versus becoming a rock star. And it was more difficult to be successful with a clothing brand than being a rock star. And so I'm looking to become, I'll be on American Idol this year, so look for me. So we wanted to be that transitional brand, and we wanted to be able to kind of move off of things. If you're familiar with brands, is they have a certain heritage, a brand heritage. So if you think of Quiksilver, if you think of Polo, of Ralph Lauren, everybody kind of has that kind of real innate DNA of who they are. And we said is, we want to be a little bit more flexible. We just didn't want to be a snowboard brand. We wanted to be something more than that. So our heritage did start in snow. We then moved into skate, then upland surf. And for in our business, in action sports, is a lot of things turn around the team. And what happens through that process is, if you look at who's ever wearing the Burton jacket, and that's what kids emulate out of. They look at it and they say, here's an icon. He wears a Neff beanie. Oh, I guess the Neff, he thinks it's cool. I guess it should be cool, and consequently, I'll buy that. Because it's how I look and how I perceive myself. And so we kind of moved into the lifestyle. So we have kind of some odd folks. Well, excuse me. We have some wonderful folks that represent the brand. And so we have Snoop Dogg, which was kind of, right? So, and then we had Jennifer Aniston. And then we had Scarlett Johansson. And then we had 2 Chainz. And then we had Wiz Khalifa. And then we had, the Sherman guys. And so we kind of moved all over the place. Some really, really wonderful, interesting people. And so through that, we've been able to kind of merge this, because usually what's very difficult from a transitional perspective, we are probably the only brand that wanted to be able to play in all these different segments. Because if you're a hardcore skate company, you can't sell it to a surfer, because it pollutes and disrupts your primary consumer group, which are skaters, and so forth. So it's been very difficult for these brands to be able to move through that. So with that, we wanted to be unique in the marketplace. Our intent was to be bright, colorful, and fun. We did want to be the coolest brand, because cool fades very quickly. Kind of goes up and down. There's that marketing curve, right? So you kind of have the rocket ship where you grow in substantially, and all of a sudden you mature out, or you age out. And that happens to us, right? So we have our customer targets, 12 to 24. That's kind of where we want to play. That's our core customer. And so at 24, you start aging out, because they start going to other brands. So, and if you look at this consumer group, right, most people don't usually wear logos, right? They don't use your college kids don't have any money to buy anything anyway. It's a horrible demographic. So we don't even care about, I'm just kidding. But so we kind of move through those things. So there's a lot of different things. So, and make it Neffy. We always want to have that little wink, something weird. Right? And so through that, we kind of went, and we first thing we did is we did a twist around. Can you stand up, young man? You're a really good looking model guy. Yeah, you can talk to me after, we can sign you up. But see, he's not aware that his hat's on backwards. But what we did was we took the brim and we made it so it would rotate 360 degrees. Okay? We bought a whole bunch of them, probably bought 5,000 of them, sold 3. But it was that little gimmick, that really kind of made it to the next point. The other thing we did is we took traditional, we came up with a snort, right? And that was a snowboard short. So you had a part, you had a technical outerwear with a pair of shorts on, and it was called a snort. And it was really, and that really got the press. That kind of got the idea of generating, because you're always looking for what? You're looking for those, that two things. You want to be a distinguisher or a disruptor? And we always said we wanted to be a disruptor. We didn't want to distinguish ourselves. We wanted to do something so unique, so far out there. So everything we look at is this 80-20 rule. And you've probably heard of that 80-20 rule, right? But our 80-20 rule really sits that is 20% of the product we make is really kind of out there that's going to be that communication device that really gets people talking about the brand, gets blogged, and gets carried. So, okay. So here's kind of our hot tub shorts. And so what we said is, we don't want a board short. We're not Quiksilver. We're not Volcom. So our whole advertising campaign, our campaign was centered around wearing this in a hot tub. And so we didn't want to have, and we've got the best surfers in the world, but we wanted it to be able to show it in that relaxation. So it wasn't the technical piece, it was the fun piece. And you see why that makes sense to us. Our other thing is, and you probably know us by the beanie, right? So that's kind of our evergreen product. When you sell over 1 million beanies a year, it becomes substantial. And so that's what we really kind of look through and we march with. Every brand needs that evergreen, that thing that just sells over and over again without tweaking it, without reinventing it. Because if you're a brand, especially in this market, where there's fast fashion, where probably a lot of you shop at H&M or Forever 21, you know, it's that quick item, which is a very value-oriented. And so our intent was to be accessible, which was kind of at a price point entry, where on a private label, meaning that at Zumiez or at Tilly's or PacSun or at Macy's or Nordstrom's where we're sold, is that we're kind of that entry point, right? We're that great brand promise says, you wear our stuff and you're gonna have some fun. And that was our daily beanie. And this gives you a little bit of idea who we are. Is there sound? There's no sound. Now you're gonna want me to restart this. So any questions so far? Okay, thank you. So, and there is, since I've been a professor most of my life, you know, taught here in the law school and in the master's, there is a 100-point quiz. We ready?
We're different. The way we see it, there's no reason to grow up if you don't want to. We say rock way more t-shirts than neckties. We say real characters have character. We say be your own Basquiat. Everybody comes with baggage, but yours should be the freshest bag around. There are no mirrors on the dance floor. We say turn up the music. Cream the competition. Run till they catch you. Sing like you own forever. Because you do. Smile more and frown less. I will be the first on the dance floor, the first down the hill, the first to talk to you. You can't stop me. I'm young. I'm bright. I would say I have swag, but I don't say swag anymore. I'm quick, but I don't hurry. For me, now is expected. Now is the point. What did they say? Your logo can't be written one at a time? You can't wear a beanie in the summertime? They got it all. Maybe a beanie can make you smile. Maybe it's okay to stand out. Maybe it's okay to have fun. Neff, forever fun.
As you can see, most of that was my age demographic. So, but I don't know how many of those people you identify, but all those, you know, all of those kind of those folks from a Steve Aoki, who's kind of electronic DJ kind of folks, and to the surfers, to Shane Johnson and so forth. Last night, staying in Park City, we have a place up there, and so Sage Kostenberg, anybody know who Sage Kostenberg is? So he won the gold medal in the slope style, so he's one of our riders. So we've really gone around this intent of really kind of pushing our place in those certain icons and then centered around being fun. So this was the issue, T's come and go. You've probably seen diamond t-shirts. Diamond was the hot t-shirt. Now it's on the other side of that curb. Brixton and so forth. So as I said, is we really wanted to focus on this product segment. We created the product segment of youth accessories. Before that, everybody made it as an afterthought, whether you're a Quicksilver, or if you're a Billabong, or if you're a Volcom, that there was really no specific design on the accessories product. And the reason for that is accessories has the highest margin, or the highest profit margin of any product, because on t-shirts it's consistently discounted down. So it's a BOGO, you buy one, get one, and so forth. So, but the margins in the accessory side is really where we wanted to play, and there was really no one sitting in that. And then we did a little bit of a flair on the clothing side, and we came up with a concept and we stuck to it. That's one of the things. There's that concept of chasing shiny objects. And through that process, there's all kinds of things. So we went down the road and somebody says, oh, why don't we do bottoms, which is Levi's. Tough business, okay? All these different sizes and so forth, and the stocking and inventory costs. So the beanie, one size fits all. It's male, it's female, and it's really kind of went through. Then we did watches, then we did eyewear, and then we did belts, and then we did bags. Then we came up with a shield with a visor. We came up with all kinds of kind of interesting little fun things. But we set in that process. So we kept the vision, we had a plan, we stuck to it. The impact of the Neff, and so what we wanted it to be is that we don't have skulls, we don't have devils, we don't have drug or anything. We wanted to be the family-friendly brand. Obviously, being a member of the church, both my sons, all of my family's gone here, and so returned missionaries. My one son, Sean, he was a bishop, and so we wanted to make sure and kind of keep those things in a place where it was mom-friendly. And so we've been really exact on that. And we've been able to carve ourselves out and keep our place in that segment and to make it mom-friendly. Because in our age group, and that's the number with that demographic, that 12 to 18, that high school kid, 80% of his spendable income comes from mom and dad. And so we wanted to make it as a price point. So when you're sitting there and you walk into Zoomies, anybody been in Zoomies? So when you walk into there, there's an eyewear display and there was a watch display. And it was $24, the same price as a t-shirt. And so it was accessible, it was affordable, it was the same point as a primary brand that had an opportunity to be able to sell. So that's where we've been. Again, customer friendly, we want to have access to people. We wanted people to really kind of center on those things that we think were important and that were associated. And we knew who we wanted to be. And from the very early on is we made a decision because we looked at it. And I said, you look at all of our competitors in the action sports market, and that they all center on that team orientation, whether it's the snowboard team, the surf team, the skate team, or kind of that lifestyle. And so what we want to do is to make my son, Sean, that icon, that he would be the primary icon for that business. So we went about, again, building that reputation, letting him be the spokesperson for the brand, and then moving that out. And we wanted to be the most fun brand. We didn't want to be cool, because cool is all relevant and so forth, but we wanted to center on and say, from an activity base, what can you do to have fun? And everything really kind of falls in it, right? And more than that, we wanted to be forever fun. So that was our mantra, that's our cry. Whether we're making our product, whether the people that we hire, that we want everybody to have a wonderful experience. So if you're an employee at Neff, that's the most important thing is we do fun things. So they go surfing at 8 o'clock in the morning and they come back and they work 2.5 hours max. But they go through that process. And so we have the Taco Friday, we have the Chili Wednesday. And so we do a lot of different things. We had a skate ramp sitting inside the warehouse. We do activities to go Disneyland, they all go snowboarding to Mammoth and so forth. So we've really tried to create that atmosphere originating with the people who work inside the environment, that translate, who designs that's their mantra and they understand that, to the product, to our messaging, to our marketing. And the one thing that we've done better than anybody else on the planet is the ability to be able to market our product and to be able to distinguish who we are in that marketplace. when anybody can see a Neff product, it's pretty identifiable. And so, again, so we looked at it, we said, look, at from those fun side, those are the things that we want to do. So every, you think about it, pretty simplistic, nothing scientific. We didn't discover the cure for cancer. So, but what we did was, is that we said every activity that a person does, whether the person's getting ready to go horseback riding or whether the person's going to go play a traditional sport like football and so forth, that he can, any, he's going to a football game, whether he's going to a party or so forth, going to go snowboarding, everything associates with fun, that's where we want to be. We want to be the number one choice of fun people. So that's where we ended up. So what we did early on, we put, everybody's probably seen the Venn diagram, and so we did a little science behind it. So my two sons, who's the face of Brand, my other son Chip, is the marketing person. So we kind of sit down and we try to look at it, and we went through and we identified activities. And we said, what are all the things that our consumer group would do? Because again, if you're trying to build a product, whether it's tangible, intangible, a service, you know, like we did at PricewaterhouseCoopers, you have to identify that consumer and the activities. When I went and sold a project to ARCO to do a restructuring project, I would sit down with the CFO and with the CEO and with the board, and you'd make a presentation. And all the science around that was, it wasn't because there was parity within the law firms we competed with, and parity within the Big Four environment, is the only thing that distinguished with you was is how that individual who was the buyer felt about your product or your service. If he could sit there and say, wow, I hired PricewaterhouseCoopers to do this, that makes sense. Oh, gee, I hired Joe Neff to be the point on this with his restructuring team. Oh, gee, I wear a Neff beanie because, wow, yeah, I feel good in it. Makes me, okay, Neff, it's kind of cool, it's fun, and so forth. So all those environments. So what we did is we lined up all the activities that associated with someone who's 12 to 24, what they're engaged in. And we said, that's where we want to play. The next one, so one of the things, it's the activities that really, so if you think about youth, they're defined by their activities. They're a tennis player, they're a football player, there's a basketball, they're an artist, they're an oboist, whatever it may be, is whatever they're a surfer and so forth. That's your class segmentation inside of a high school. That's what it is. What you do defines who you are, to a certain degree. And so the other point was, is what music you listen to. If you're in Nampa, you listen to country western music or you get beat up. And so, you know, so you kind of go through that process. That's what's real. So what type of music do they listen to? Are they hip hop? Are they electronic? And so forth, they're running through that. The other thing then we looked at, people are defined by their clothing. And so what we said was, well, that connection between those activities should be Neff on the accessory side. And so that was our science behind the product and everything that we do which is associated with that. We wanted to be consistent in the branding, in from a design perspective. You've all probably all taken that, your brand promise, right? And that promise is okay, from design side to the product side to the marketing side, and then, you know, through the messaging. And our messaging was through action sport athletes, through lifestyle celebrities, and music and collaborations. So that's why we consistently went through and we signed a DJ like Steve Aiko and so forth, who's the number one DJ. He gets paid, I don't know, $500,000 a night. And so through that process, so through those all those things that we looked to do was to make things iconic. And so we wanted one consistent message, and that message was about being forever fun. So we wanted to stay relevant within our environment. And kind of define these things. And these are the big questions of relevancy. Whether whatever you're creating or whatever you're building is people have to know exactly who you are. Whether you're selling an oil filter, whether you're selling Doritos, or whether you're selling a beanie. But people have to know what your message is, what the product expectation, and what those items up there. And then the second one is, who do you want to be, right? So where's that growth opportunity, and where can you match those up? And so we went through all the science, and this is one of the things that's really kind of significant to us. In the consumer business, or in the apparel business, is that the most important thing for you is what other products that you sit next to. And so on that entry table, so as you'll start to see, eye level, if you walk into Vons, you'll see where all the Kellogg's, they pay, you know, $150,000 a week to be able to have their cereal at eye level. And if you'll look at the messaging, that when you walk into a store, like a Zumiez or a PacSun or a Nordstrom's or Macy, depending what door you walk in, you'll see the initial lay table. That initial lay table is either purchased or because it's the hot brand that's associated with that. And so for us, it was important as we grew our distribution of saying, okay, well, where's Volcom? Where's Billabong? Where's Hurley? Where's DC? Those are the people that we want to be next to. And those are the products that drive your product and that gives that consumer that choice. So kind of a takeaway is, if I was sitting there and kind of looking at kind of where we are and who we are, there's a number of things I think is very important is one is that creativity side of that people, is the people of your associations and the people that you really originate with. And what are the things that you want to do with those individuals and those activities? We talked about the right in that front end about the product and the impact of product, the impact of people. Those are the two most critical pieces in any business that you're building, right? Is one of the individuals associated with Donald Trump, my hero, the most brilliant man that I've ever met, outside my pet gopher. But you know, interesting thing, he has a great book, right? And he says, the one thing I've really done is that I've hired the best people and the smartest people and to be able to associate with. And the key to any success is you always have the founders. And if you watch, you know, if you think of Steve Jobs or you think of any of these people that have gone through that kind of that initial foundation and you're that founder and so forth, at some point in time, you grow out of yourself and you grow out of those initial points. I look at the people that we had. We had people that worked with us who lived and breathed Neff. And they worked free for 3 and 4 years and so forth and you know, or work on an internship and so forth while they were going to school. But they were believers. And through that process, because of their energy and because of their desire to see the brand significant, that made the whole difference in everything that we did because we had believers. And we had people who wanted to do the right things for the right brand and felt part of that Neff family. That translated into that product to make sure that our consumer could feel that. That they believed in that product and they wanted that product and they can move consistently. As you kind of go up that brand curve and so forth, then it became a process issue. And when you're dealing with millennials, which is all like you, I'm obviously the oldest guy in the building. Our average employee is 24 years of age. And we have 80 people that sit in our main office. We have another sales force of probably in the US of another 55, and then we have 51 different countries that we have probably another 150, 200 people in. And so through all of that, that's a very young, youth-oriented group because that buyer wants to buy that product from someone who looks like them. And so through all of that process, so at some point in time though, that a lot of these folks, this is their first job or maybe their second job, and they didn't grow up in a corporate environment. So that process issue was a big deal. The most important other thing is again, looking at that uniqueness of who and what we are and how do we become unique. And so I think that's one of the significant challenges is certainly in our day and age, and we're gonna talk a little bit about this vision and luck. And I think the vision is that, you know, again, when we started out, it was going to be a hobby, it's going to be fun, we're going to do some things, a little family-oriented business, and you know what, if it paid the bills for my two sons, that would be a great thing. Well, obviously, it turned in much more significant than that. And so through that vision consistently changed and regrouped. So as more of the product and more of the process, but that initial vision of who we wanted to be, the fun brand, the relevant brand to that consumer, and do the things that we felt would drive those activities associated with our consumer base, those were always our number one question. And our question always is, when we ever start that meeting or conclude that meeting, did it further the vision? And that you can call that a mission statement, you can call it corporate values, whatever the science around that. But it was really that mantra of what are those things that drive that brand and what can we do to further the brand? And we never really swayed from that. Most companies panicked, and right now there's a huge economic downturn in the retail side. And the business is changing, right? So if you're a consumer, and probably most of you, how many of you buy, during the Christmas time, did you buy a product online for the holidays? So one of our challenges has been our traditional is brick and mortar. That's our retailer, right? Because it's the emotional driver, it's the packaging. One of the things we just recently launched with Kevin Durant. Kevin Durant, we did a joint venture with Kevin. Kevin is a minority interest in an underwear brand that we called Neff Headwear, and it was launched in Foot Locker, and at Nordstrom's. And so we went through that process of really designing and deciding what we were, and we moved into a completely transitional type market for us. We talked about the ability to be able to be the nimble kind of brand. We can do things so much quicker and so much easier than other brands because we don't have a lot of that corporate hierarchy, and we've tried to keep it of such. And so we moved into completely new doors where we are with Kevin Durant, and which was a completely new product line. And what we did was we tried to find this fun product in a market segment that was kind of aged out and unexciting. And we branded it and put it out, and the release has been great. So through that, it's in that vision the other side. So the one thing I cannot downplay is luck. You can buy luck, you can find luck, you can have a potluck, you can do a lot of things, okay, with luck. And we were really kind of at the right time at the right place. And I think you ever talk to anybody who's been a builder and who started businesses and so forth, and in my career, I spent most of my career in Fortune 100 companies and a board of directors meetings of making presentations and helping people to make great decisions. And so through that, you look at all these different products and so forth, and you look at the success of people in the right place at the right time. And really a lot of it was associated with Neff of a little bit of a luck, right? Because we had the right time, we had a tremendous amount of passion and desire in my son to be able to move the product. He was nice to have enough dad who funded it for 7 years. And so we had no debt, we owed nobody, and 100% ownership in the business. And that's very unusual. If you look at Skullcandy with Rick, which is a good friend of ours, and through Skullcandy and so forth, by the time they did their IPO, they had probably 150 different investors. There you kind of ratched down and you sold and you had to piece off of things to be able to acquire the capital. So we were fortunate to be able to do that, is that we were able to self-fund it and grow it and define who we are. And we didn't have a lot of peripherals, right, of individuals, of investors, of telling us, well, let's do the safe thing, let's do this course. The one interesting thing on the luck side is, so our daily beanie, which is our standard little beanie, you know, and that we sell, again, you know, seven figures every year for the last, you know, 6 years. And the interesting thing about that is like most companies, there's a word, and it's a very scientific, technical process. You know, we spent hundreds and thousands of hours of looking at that beanie. Not true. We took a beanie, we wanted to knock it off, we sent it to China. It came back completely different. It was stretchy, kind of fell apart. We're going, really, this is what we want? And so, no, we wanted this. So we sent it back again, came back in the same way. We're going, man, what is with this, you know? And so we've had a captive relationship with one of our suppliers that's in China, and it kept coming back. So the third time the thing came back, the third way, we said, well, it's meant to be. And so we went and showed it. It took off, it became that daily or evergreen product, and it was an accident of a bad product that really put Neff on the map. And so you can sit there and you can study all the science and you can take a look at all the processes and so forth, but there's really something that becomes luck. It becomes that magic. And the magic in the bottle for us was that little daily beanie. And really that's what started. And the interesting thing about it, we said, and as Sean was talking about on that one, it says, can't wear a beanie during the summer. We were selling 80,000 beanies in July. Okay, which just, come on, what's wrong with that? So, but it was that lifestyle issue. And then you got it on, you know, then you had Brad Pitt, and you just had some other people that kind of the iconic people that saw it and so forth and said, oh, that, well, Brad wears it. It's got to be cool. Okay. And so we went through that whole process. So the intuition or the reasoning and all the science that you can do associated with building, but there's got to be some timing on the luck side, and you got to have a little bit of luck on the product. And it's interesting right now. I probably get 5 to 6 emails and are approached by private equity groups and so forth of saying, wow, we got this great idea and this great product. You want to take a look at it, and they want to make the pitch, right? And so I get that pitch all the time. And but it's just very interesting as you sit there and you associate it with, and you look at those products and you say, wow, okay? But if there's a couple things that's in that ingredient, is if there's a little bit of luck, and if there's some passion associated with it, and if it's relevant to that buyer, then you're going to have some additional sense of putting those things together. So, your story. So those are kind of my tech kind of things. I do one of the things I got to do at PricewaterhouseCoopers was develop PricewaterhouseCoopers, their Coopers University. And it was really kind of putting together all the management tools for the partners of really going through processes and looking at it. So one of the things is, everybody know what SWOT means? Who's the smartest guy in the room? Donald, are you here? Okay, would you, your name is?
Cedric.
Cedric, can you stand up so I can't see you? Okay. Generally, when is that employed?
Generally, whenever you're basing on how your company is doing, where your weaknesses are, I can prove where your opportunities are.
Is your girlfriend here? I'd like to ask her what your weaknesses are. Or so she's not here.
Oh,
okay. Well, that's good. You don't have a girlfriend. But so through that, you think about, that's one of those identifiers, right? So my challenge, first of all, to each one of you, if you're looking at kind of where you are in your career perspective. Okay, you're getting the golden ticket to play. You're getting an opportunity to play. I was the regional recruiting partner for PwC at major universities for 10, 15 years. And so as you went through there, everybody that I would interview, okay, top 5%, you know, they were, you know, summa cum laude, you know, they wrote this, they did that, you know, they could ride a unicycle upside down. They could do all these wonderful things, right? And so the last question I would always ask them is, you know what? I'm going to see, during the course of the next 3 days, 50 people with the same resume, with the same pedigree, and what's the one thing that makes you unique? And why should I remember you at the end of the day? And I think that's the one thing you want to take a look at yourself, right? Whether you're looking at building your own business, whether you're looking at a software, you're looking to go into industry, or if you're gonna, whatever that may be, if you're looking to be a circus clown. So through all those things, you've got to really do a relevance and do that SWOT analysis for yourself. And you got to sit there and ask your question is, what's my strengths? What are the things I need to develop upon? What are my opportunities with my degree? What are my opportunities with my GPA? Okay, where does everything sit around to be able to, and what are the threats to those things I want to accomplish? Okay, the middle question is ADD. Who has ADD? Oh, you do? Congratulations. So you're going to be successful. So one of the things is, this is really goes back to that product, right? How can I accelerate a product? How can I affect it? How can I distinguish it? And how can I disrupt the product base? So really, those are those three products. And if you're whether you're an individual product yourself, acquiring intellect and intelligence, and skills, or whether you're looking to build a product or you're looking to build a service. What are those things that really distinguish you, and how do you disrupt the market? The last question is, you need help every step of the way. You know, it's interesting. If you look at founders of Volcom, everybody knows Volcom. That was a father and a son. If you look at the founders of Quicksilver, if you look at the founders of Microsoft, if you look at the founder of Apple, there was always a relationship that came from a family member to be able to help that next generation to be able to grow. And so through that process I'm a firm believer, is that as mentors, as builders, to be able to find individuals and associate yourself with those individuals that can give you that help. It could be advice, it could be intellect, it could be an introduction, It could be the networking. It could be capital. But whatever that is, you need help every step of the way. The last is, we talked a little bit about the DNA, what it builds in that, the sciencess, and then building uniqueness. So with that, just a kind of couple of final things. Jack Canfield is, you know, this is a really an interesting thing, is that, and I think this is an absolute truism, that the people that you associate with, you are the average of those individuals. I say is, whatever you spend your time thinking about, and whatever you are doing, that's who really truly defines you with the individuals. And it's really kind of centers around that law of the harvest, right? Is what you put into life, what you put into yourself, what you put into a product, what you put into a brand, what you put into your education, what you put into your work, what you put into your marriage, what you put into your children, you absolutely will get that result based upon your passion, your ability, and the conclusions of life will be directly related to what your input is. So they affect and span your time and the decisions you make and affect the way other people see you. And that's what those other are. And so that's where that net weakening is so important. And so with that, a couple things. So here's a final exercise that I really love to do. So if you just sit there and you jot down and you look at it and you say on the red side, what are the things I need to do immediately in my life to be able to stop that is precluding me from achieving the goals I want to? On the yellow side is, what are the things I want to continue to do? And the green, what are the new things I want to do? And really move down that process. So with that, thank you, and that's it.